Nylon is an extremely important plastic polymer that's used to make clothing and a whole bunch of other products. There are a few different types of nylon, and the one that I want to make is specifically known as nylon 66. In order to make it, I'm going to be following this reaction scheme, which is the typical industrial route to nylon 66. On the left side, it starts with cyclohexanol, which is converted to adipic acid and then to adipoyl chloride. The adipoyl chloride is then reacted with hexamethylene diamine to form the final nylon 66. The reason why we call it nylon 66 is because each of the precursors, i.e. the hexamethylene diamine and the adipoyl chloride, both have 6 carbons in them. Unfortunately, I don't have a reasonable way to make the hexamethylene diamine, and I'm just gonna have to buy it. Because of this, I'm gonna be focusing almost entirely on this left side of the reaction scheme, starting with cyclohexanol. Cyclohexanol is typically converted to adipic acid by heating it in nitric acid along with a metal catalyst. However, this produces a lot of nitrous oxide gas, which contributes to both global warming and the depletion of the ozone. For many reactions, this wouldn't really be a huge issue, but adipic acid is produced on a massive scale. Despite efforts to trap, recycle, or neutralize the nitrous oxide, this process still releases more than 400,000 metric tons per year. The wastefulness of this method is not unique, and there are countless other industrial processes like it. Fortunately, in the past few decades, we've become more environmentally aware, and a lot of effort has been put into making cleaner and more efficient methods. This effort has spawned a relatively recent but very popular area of chemistry known as green chemistry. The main goal of green chemistry is to reduce or eliminate the use and production of hazardous waste materials. Anyway, with green chem in mind, I decided to make adipic acid in a more environmentally friendly way. With a little bit of searching, I found a modified method that doesn't produce any nitrous oxide, but is supposed to have the same or better yields. In the old synthesis, I would have used nitric acid, a metal catalyst, and cyclohexanol. In the reaction, the nitric acid is being used as an oxidizing agent, but the problem with it is that it's also the source of the nitrous oxide gas. In this new prep, we still need to use a metal catalyst and cyclohexanol, but instead of using nitric acid here, it's swapped for a new oxidizer, hydrogen peroxide. With hydrogen peroxide, the reaction won't release any nitrous oxide gas, and the only thing that comes off is going to be oxygen. On top of this, the reaction mixture is recyclable. Once the reaction's done, we can add a little bit more peroxide, add some more cyclohexanol, and the reaction can be repeated. The old method is kind of a one-and-done kind of deal. So this modified method not only eliminates the release of nitrous oxide gas, but it also reduces waste because the reaction mixture can be used in multiple cycles. Okay, so getting started with the reaction, everything I used is shown here. On the left, I have 30% hydrogen peroxide, in the middle I have some powdered tungsten metal, and on the right is the cyclohexanol. The tungsten metal and the cyclohexanol were purchased from eBay, but I had to get the peroxide locally. The procedure that I'm following is from a paper that I found online, and I'll provide a link to it in the description. The tungsten metal is not used directly in the prep, and before starting, it needs to be converted into tungstinic acid. Luckily for me, this is actually pretty easy to do. Into a small beaker, I add a stir bar and about 40 milliliters of hydrogen peroxide. I then add a small amount of tungsten powder. I turn on the stirring, but I don't turn on the heating, because the reaction between the tungsten metal and the peroxide is exothermic. The reaction at room temperature is slow, but as they react and generate heat, the reaction will speed up. As the solution gets hotter, we'll start to see steam coming off and a bunch of bubbling. Anyway, what we have going on here is hydrogen peroxide reacting with the tungsten metal to form tungstinic acid. Tungstinic acid is normally insoluble in water, but in the presence of peroxide, it forms a water-soluble complex. As far as I know, this complex doesn't really have a name, but it's the active catalyst for the reaction. The reaction is done when it doesn't look like there's any tungsten left. My solution here is murky, and in theory it should be perfectly clear, but I think my tungsten metal wasn't very pure. I quickly set up the reaction flask, and I added the catalyst to it.
I wash the beaker with a decent amount of hydrogen peroxide, and I transfer this to the flask as well. With the catalyst in the flask, I then top it off with a bunch more peroxide. With the catalyst and all of the hydrogen peroxide loaded in the flask, it's time to add the cyclohexanol. With strong stirring, I pour in about 100 grams, and the solution quickly becomes white. Cyclohexanol is not very soluble in water, so with the stirring, we get a very fine and opaque dispersion. If I turned off the stirring, it should clear up, and the cyclohexanol would separate as a layer above the water. The reaction doesn't really happen at room temperature, and to get things going, we need to heat it up. The target temperature is 90 C, and I need to hold it there for about 20 hours. For this reaction, temperature control is very important, which is why I have the thermometer in the left neck. In the middle, I have a condenser, which should recondense any vapors that come off. It's important to have the condenser because the reaction is kept at a high temperature for a long period of time. If no condenser was used, most of the water would probably evaporate before we even got to the 20-hour mark. Anyway, continuing with the reaction, I turn on the heating mantle and I slowly raise the temperature to the 90 C mark. When it got to about 85 C, the bubbling just took off and the temperature spiked to about 100. I had to quickly remove the heating mantle and cool things down using some cold water. This was really unexpected because I was following a paper and they never mentioned anything like this happening. Anyway, the cold water worked pretty well and the reaction quickly slowed down. Without the stirring, the cyclohexanol separates and you can see that it forms a layer above the hydrogen peroxide. The reaction was cooled down to about 85 C, but it very quickly took off again. For the next 5 hours, it was a cycle of cooling it down and then letting it heat up again. The fact that this isn't mentioned at all in the paper really makes me think that something weird is going on. Anyway, this is the reaction that's supposed to be occurring. In the presence of the tungsten catalyst and hydrogen peroxide, the cyclohexanol is being oxidized to adipic acid. In terms of the mechanism, this is what was suggested by the authors of the paper. It starts with cyclohexanol, which is oxidized by peroxide to form cyclohexanone. The cyclohexanone then undergoes a Bayer-Villiger reaction, which converts the cyclic ketone to a lactone group. The caprolactone is slowly hydrolyzed by water, which breaks apart the ring and forms 6-hydroxycaproic acid. The hydroxyl group is then further oxidized to form an aldehyde. In the final step, the aldehyde group is oxidized to a carboxylic acid, which gives us the final adipic acid. Eventually, the reaction got more under control, and I was able to stir it like this for the next 2 or 3 hours. The temperature remained pretty constant at around 94 C. After a few hours of stirring, the reaction died down and the temperature started to drop. I turned off the stirring, and this time, you can see no layer of cyclohexanol forms at the top, and we actually have some stuff forming at the bottom. When I stopped the stirring earlier, a layer of cyclohexanol formed at the top, but apparently that's all gone now. Because the temperature was dropping, I put the heating mantle back on and I started to heat things again. I really thought that the bulk of the reaction was over, but once I got to around 85 to 90 C, the reaction took off again. It didn't get too crazy, so just like before, I just kept stirring it. The temperature rose to about 95 C and then remained pretty constant. Over the next 2 hours, the solution slowly cleared up and started to look kind of like a lava lamp. I don't think it's working in the same way though, because lava lamps require a gradient in temperature where it's hot on the bottom and cold at the top. In a lava lamp, wax gets hot at the bottom, which reduces its density, so it floats to the top where it cools, increases its density, and sinks back down. In my case, I have really strong stirring, so the temperature should be more or less uniform. I'm not exactly sure what's happening, but I think oxygen bubbles are pulling the globs to the surface, then once the globs lose the oxygen, they sink back down. I honestly have no idea what these globs are, but whatever they are, they have to be denser than the hydrogen peroxide solution. All of the intermediates that were suggested in the paper don't have a density above that of hydrogen peroxide, so I honestly have no idea what this is. Just for fun, I turned off the stirring so I could get the full lava lamp effect. As the globs fall down, they coalesce around the stir bar, and I think it's much clearer here that the bubbles are just carrying the globs back to the surface. I crank up the stirring again, and over the course of the next hour or so, most of the globs disappear. I also started to see something crystallize on the sides of the flask. At first, I thought these were adipic acid crystals, but I don't think they are. Anyway, the temperature started to decrease, and I actually needed the heating mantle from this point on. I removed the stopper and I smelled the vapors, and the stench was unmistakable. What I'm smelling here is 6-hydroxycaproic acid, which is kind of a musty, vomit-like smell. Although it's stinky, it's still a good sign, because it means we're getting close to the final adipic acid. Around the 15-hour mark, the solution started to become opaque as adipic acid precipitated out. Over the course of the next 5 hours, a lot more adipic acid was formed, but it was more or less pretty mundane. At the 20-hour mark, I took off the heating mantle and I let the mixture cool overnight. I came back around 12 hours later and we can see a lot of adipic acid at the bottom. To get out as much adipic acid as possible, I placed the flask in a freezer for about an hour. I then filtered it off using my 1-liter funnel that was flagged by customs and then investigated by the RCMP. I used as little water as possible to transfer everything from the flask to the funnel. I washed the sides with a little bit of distilled water, and then I mixed things around to wash the adipic acid. I only did one washing step, but in hindsight, I really should have done more, and you'll see why in a few minutes. Once I was done washing it, I left the vacuum pump running to dry it up as much as possible. I was left with some crude and relatively dry adipic acid, which I transferred to a beaker. The adipic acid isn't very pure right now, and to clean it up, I need to do a recrystallization. I have about 95 grams of crude adipic acid, and I found a resource online that says it can be recrystallized in 2.5 times its weight in water. I don't add the water all at once, and I start by adding about 200 milliliters. I turn on the hot plate and the stirring, and I wait for things to heat up. When it got close to boiling, I added the final 50 milliliters, and I waited for it to boil again. The solution was supposed to clear up after all the water was added, but it stayed opaque. I tried adding a bunch more water to try to get things to dissolve, but it didn't really do much of anything. There's some sort of white impurity floating around that isn't dissolving, and I need to get rid of it somehow. I tried to do a hot filtration through a couple coffee filters, and that clearly didn't work. I tried to pull it through a Buchner funnel that was packed with very fine filter paper, but that didn't work either. This is the only thing that seemed to work decently. The solution was reboiled, and I let it stand for the solid to sink to the bottom. I then poured off the liquid, and I left behind the solid stuff. Unfortunately, I don't think it's very easy to clean up further, so I just let it crystallize. Because the solution was opaque, the crystallization wasn't very pretty to look at. After it cooled down to room temperature, I put it in the freezer and chilled it to around 0°C. I then brought back my glass Buchner funnel, loaded it with a filter paper, and filtered off all of my adipic acid. All of the impurities that made the solution opaque should still be present, and because they passed through the filter, I figured that I could probably wash them away here. So using ice-cold water, I washed the adipic acid a few times. In the flask below, you can see that what I'm collecting is opaque. Unfortunately, adipic acid is minorly soluble in water, so I have to make sure that I don't overdo the washings. There's definitely some of this impurity still left over, but there's not much I can do. I'm hoping I can purify it out in the next step when I make adipoyl chloride. So to move on, I pulled the vacuum for a few minutes to try to dry things up as much as possible. The adipic acid was transferred to a piece of printer paper with some paper towel underneath. I left it out for about a day or two, and I was left with a nice dry powder. The final yield was about 50 grams of adipic acid, and this is extremely low. On top of this, I measured the purity by taking the melting point, and what I have here is not very pure. The paper that I'm following advertised a yield of about 127 grams, and they also said that it would be quite pure. I did a little bit of investigating, and I think I found out why my yield is so low, and it has nothing to do with the paper. The major reason seems to be really bad quality cyclohexanol. Pure cyclohexanol has a melting point around 26°C, so it's pretty common for it to be solid at room temperature, which is around 20°C. Well, the cyclohexanol that I have doesn't start to solidify below 26°C, it starts to solidify below negative 3°C. It was supposed to be pretty pure, but if it's not solidifying nearly 30°C below the melting point, well, it's definitely pretty dirty. This might explain why the reaction took off in the beginning, because maybe the peroxide was reacting with something else in the cyclohexanol. This also might have led to the formation of all of that white and soluble stuff at the end. The impurity likely represented a large percentage of the cyclohexanol, and this would inevitably impact the yield. So with all of that being said, I think it's a good idea to redistill the cyclohexanol before doing this reaction. It didn't suggest to do this in the paper, and unfortunately, it didn't occur to me at all. In the end though, 50 grams of adipic acid is more than I need, so I'm not going to bother repeating this. I have a feeling that if I were to redistill my cyclohexanol and do the whole thing over again, it would go exactly as it described it in the paper. Anyway, as I said before, the next thing that I need to do is convert it to adipoyl chloride. To do this, I need to use the chemical thionyl chloride, which has just been sitting around and waiting for me to use for about a year now. The next video is either going to be the adipoyl chloride one, or I'm going to continue recycling my mercury and convert the mercury sulfide I got from the previous video back to mercury metal. Also, I finally received my NileRed beakers, and I've opened up a shop online. The website is just nilered.ca, and if any of you are interested in checking it out, there's a link in the description. Right now, the site only accepts orders from Canada or the US, so if you're from somewhere else and you want to get something, just send me an email at this address here. So as usual, I'd like to thank everyone who's supporting me on Patreon. Everyone who supports me will see my videos 24 hours before I release them to YouTube. On top of this, all of my supporters can directly message me on Patreon with any questions or comments that they have. And I do my best to respond within about a day or so to all of my Patreon messages. Also, if you support me with $5 or more, you'll get your name at the end of the video like you see here. Here's just a small list of some of the future videos that I'll post. If you guys have any other ideas, please let me know in the comments.